truth and grace, so that all might know they have a rightful place. Be ever ancient and new, breaking through our deafness so we hear you, shattering the darkness of night. A new dawn is rising to bring your light to all the world. Let us
hello, everybody. Welcome to Monday of this 14th week. Glad to have you once again. Hope you had a wonderful weekend. We're just honored to be able to continue to penetrate the scriptures with you each and every day. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Jesus wants desperately to heal you of everything and anything that might need to be healing. Body, spirit, soul, heart. Let's ask him for his mercy. And Lord Jesus, you do heal the sick. Lord, have mercy. You bring pardon and peace to sinners. Christ, have mercy. You feed us today with your word. Lord, have mercy. And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. And let us pray. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a broken, fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy. For on these your servants, rescued from the slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Jacob departed from Beersheba and proceeded toward Haran. When he came upon a certain shrine, as the sun had already set, he stopped there for the night. Taking one of the stones at the shrine, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep at that spot. Then he had a dream. A stairway rested on the ground, with its top reaching it to the heavens, and God's messengers were going up and down on it. And there was the Lord standing beside him and saying, I, the Lord, am the God of your forefather Abraham and the God of Isaac. The land on which you are lying, I will give to you and your descendants. These shall be as plentiful as the dust of the earth. And through them you shall spread out east and west, north and south. In you and your descendants, all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. Know that I am with you. I will protect you wherever you go and bring you back to this land. I will never leave you until I have done what I promised you. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he exclaimed, truly, the Lord is in this spot, although I did not know it. In solemn wonder, he cried out, how awesome is this shrine! This is nothing else but an abode of God, and that is the gateway to heaven. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone that he had put under his head, set it up as a memorial stone, and poured oil on top of it. He called the site Bethel, whereas the former name of the town had been Luz. Jacob then made this vow: "If God remains with me to protect me on this journey I am making, and to give me enough bread to eat and clothing to wear, and I come back safe to my father's house, the Lord be my God. This stone that I have set up as a memorial stone shall be God's abode." The word of the Lord.
The Lord is my refuge. The Lord is my refuge. The Lord is my refuge. Oh. The Lord is my refuge. The Lord is my refuge. The Lord is my refuge. Oh.
You who dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, say to the Lord, "My refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." He will rescue you from the snare of the fowler, from the destroying pestilence. With his pinions he will cover you, and under his wings you shall take refuge. Because he clings to me, I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he acknowledges my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in distress.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. While Jesus was speaking, an official came forward, knelt down before him, and said, "My daughter has just died. But come, lay your hands on her, and she will live." Jesus rose, he gets up, and he follows him. And so did his disciples. A woman suffering hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him, touched the tassel of his cloak. She said to herself, "If only I touched his cloak, I'll be cured." Jesus turned around and saw her and said, "Courage, daughter, your faith has saved you." And from that hour, the woman was cured. When Jesus arrived at the official's house and saw the flute players and the crowd who were making a commotion, he said, "Go away. The girl was not dead, but sleeping." And they ridiculed him. When the crowd was put out, he came and took her by the hand, and the little girl arose. The news of this spread throughout the whole land. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So you and I, I just come out of COVID. Well, we're still around, but we just come out of the COVID quarantine, I guess. So quarantining, shutting everything down, renewed fears and worries about sanitation. COVID has got everybody kind of freaked out. We're the most sanitized people on the planet ever, I think. But somehow or other, we somehow think that we're going to get it in various different ways. But anyway, it's just a fear that we have. And we're not alone. The ancient world was similar to all that. The time of Jesus, I mean, not just Jews, but everybody had these tremendous fears about germs and how much trouble they could cause, and hygiene and cleanliness. They had very strict clothes about all that. Like, for example, well, look what they did with lepers or anybody with a skin disease. They thought all of it was somehow contagious. Look at what they did to those folks. But there's a lot of wisdom to that because it was trying to keep society safe. Now, the Jews had two particular regulations that were very, very important to them. For religious reasons and also for sanitation reasons, and you would think the same thing maybe. First of all, touching a dead body. And second of all, touching a woman with internal bleeding. Both of these things were considered to be things you just simply were not able to do. And in this double story that we just read here today, Jesus does both of them. He touches a woman, or a woman touches him, who has internal bleeding, and he touches a corpse. But let's watch this from The Chosen, this woman who has this internal bleeding, as she risks everything to reach out and touch Jesus. It's really important to watch her. She's the important one here. Let's watch.
Now.
Sorry.
What's going on? What's wrong? Who touched me?
Everybody back.
Back.
They all have.
Someone touched me.
I felt that power went out of me.
Whoever touched me, come forward.
Teacher.
It was me. Just the fringe of your garment, only the edge, I promise. You are not unclean.
Why my garment?
I'm sorry. I know I should have asked. But if you touched me, it would make you ritually unclean according to the law. I was sick. I was sick for 12 years. I bled and no one could stop it. But I believed if I could just touch a piece of your garment. And I was right. Thank you.
Who told you I could heal?
A man from the pool. And he was right. The blood has ceased.
My daughter.
I'm no one's daughter anymore.
Look up. Yes, you are. Daughter. It wasn't my piece of clothing that healed you.
But it was instant. I felt it right away.
I know, but it wasn't this. It was your faith.
Teacher, she was bleeding so long. We can take her.
She is clean. You have blessed me today. And I know. My daughter, I know it has been a fight for you for so long. You must be exhausted. Go now in peace. Your faith has made you well. I wish I could stay here longer, but I have business to attend to. Someone else has faith like yours. But I'm so glad that we found each other.
No Jew would have missed the point. Now, ordinarily, Jesus would be unclean, which means he would have to be quarantined for a day. He would have washed himself and washed all his clothes. But here are two quick important points. Number one, the woman and the girl didn't make Jesus unclean. He made them clean. It's the exact opposite. This new kingdom Jesus brings the exact opposite. Somehow Jesus, if we can put it this way, infects both of them in a certain way. And secondly, both times Jesus says, it's your faith that makes the difference. Now, what does that mean? We were talking about this in our adult education class just this last week. Does that mean we're supposed to conjure something up, some kind of faith? We were talking about Jesus turning water into wine in the class, and someone asked, wait a minute, are we supposed to be able to do that kind of stuff too because Jesus was like us? Well, I sometimes wonder if we wouldn't be doing very similar things if we had the risk, the recklessness of Jesus to follow the will of his Father. So the big difference here for us, I think, is a deep desire for Jesus, a willingness to do reckless things, put our reputation on the line sometimes, to trust Jesus with everything without condition. And I think that would make a difference for us. When you and I really, really trust Jesus and we don't put conditions on it, you know, got to be this way, got to be that way, I think we will be able to do some of the same things Jesus does. He came to save us, to rescue us, to heal us, but we put up conditions to be healed. And when it comes to us healing other people, we oftentimes put up those conditions ourselves. Does that make sense? I think if we were recklessly following Jesus as he recklessly followed the Father, not the cross necessarily. I mean, our lives aren't meant to be like Jesus in the same way. Our circumstance, our situation, recklessly following Jesus, I think we'd be doing pretty much the same things he'd be doing. That's the faith they're talking about. Look at the recklessness of the woman with the internal bleeding. Look at the recklessness of this official who asked Jesus to raise his daughter from the dead. Both of them, if Jesus would have failed in either way, they're lost. They're done. But they risk God with everything, and Jesus matches the risk. Here's my question for today. What condition do you put up that prevents you from experiencing Jesus and his healing touch? So thank you, folks, for joining me. It is an honor to be able to share all this with you. I am grateful and looking forward to seeing you very, very soon. Goodbye now.